Dear friends, welcome back. In this video, we are going to take a first look at one of my favorite new displays, this circular display powered by the GC9A01 driver. It is an amazing display because its circular design opens up new possibilities for creative projects. In this video, I'll show you how to connect it to a Raspberry Pi Pico board and program it using Arduino. I'll also share some demo programs and a cheat sheet to help you get started as quickly as possible. Let's get started. I came across this display a while ago and its round shape immediately caught my eye. It is the first circular display I have ever used and I have always wanted to build a stylish clock. This display is perfect for that. What makes this display so exciting is how clear and colorful it is. It is a 1.28-inch TFT LCD with IPS technology, so it looks great from any angle, whenever you are indoors or outdoors. The 240x240 resolution makes everything sharp and easy to read. Its small size and unique round design makes it perfect for projects like clock, gauges, or dashboards. I can't wait to start building my clock with it. It's also really practical to work with. Powered by the GC9A01 driver chip, it's supported by well-known libraries like the Adafruit GFX library and the TFT ESPi, which makes programming straightforward and beginner-friendly. The display uses an SPI connection, keeping the wiring simple and efficient. The version I'm using runs on 3.3 volts, making it a perfect match for boards like the Raspberry Pi Pico or the ESP32. If you are using a 5-volt board like the Arduino Uno, you will need a level shifter to step down the voltage, or you can choose another version of the display that directly supports 5-volt inputs. Now let's see how to connect the display to the Raspberry Pi Pico board. The first pin of the display is ground, so I connect the ground pin of the Raspberry Pi Pico to the ground rail of the breadboard. Then I connect the ground pin of the display to the same ground rail on the breadboard. Next, the VCC pin of the display needs 3.3 volts. I connect the 3.3 volt output pin of the Raspberry Pi Pico to the power rail of the breadboard and then connect the VCC pin of the display to the same power rail. Next, the SEL pin clock is connected to GP18 and the SDA pin data is connected to GP19 of the Raspberry Pi Pico board. The reset pin is connected to GP16 while the DC pin is connected to GP17. The CS chip select pin goes to GP20. And finally, the backlight pin is connected to 3.3 volts. That's it, our connections are ready. Let's power up the board and see what happens. I have already loaded a demo sketch and as you can see, it displays a Hello World message on the screen. Beautiful. Our hardware setup is working perfectly. Let's now see the software we need to drive this display. I am going to use Arduino today, so I open up the latest version of the Arduino IDE at the time of this recording. All we have to do is to click here at the Library Manager button, search for the Adafruit GC9A01 library and press the Install button. The library also requires the Adafruit GFX library to work, so if it is not installed on your system, install that as well. Now that the required libraries are installed, we can use it at once. As you can see, the code in this example is very straightforward. First, we create a TFT object and then call a few simple methods to control it. We start by initializing the display with the TFT begin method and we set the rotation to 0. Then we clear the screen with the TFT fill screen method and set the background color to black. Then we set the text color and size to customize how the text appears on the screen. Next, we position the cursor at the desired X and Y coordinates on the screen using the setCursor method, and we display the Hello World message with the print method. That's all there is to it, simple and easy, right? Now that we have covered how to set up the display and show text, let's explore how to draw shapes on this circular display. The Adafruit library makes it incredibly easy to draw shapes like lines, rectangles, and circles, even on a round screen. While the display is circular, it operates using a square coordinate system. This means the top left corner of the screen is 0,0, and the bottom right corner corresponds to 240,240 for this display. Let's draw a rectangle to see how to draw on a circular display. Let's add this line of code which draws a rectangle. tft.fillrect parentheses 0,0,100,50, GC9A01A_red. This line calls the fillRect method of the TFT object, which draws a red rectangle starting at 0,0 with a width of 100 pixels and a height of 50 pixels. The rectangle is aligned with the top left corner of the display. However, since the display is circular, parts of the rectangle that extend outside the circle will be clipped. The process of drawing on a circular display is exactly the same as drawing on a rectangular one. The key difference is that you may need to perform additional calculations to ensure your graphics fit entirely within the circular area. For example, if you are drawing a large rectangle, you might need to check its dimensions and placement to avoid it being clipped by the edges of the circle. As you can see from this simple project, even for the simplest project in Arduino, we rely on classes, objects, and methods. In other words, we are already using object-oriented programming. But here's the thing, if you are not familiar with object-oriented programming, or if it feels confusing and overwhelming, don't worry, I've got you covered. I have created a course called Object-Oriented Programming Made Easy to help you master object-oriented programming concepts in a simple and practical way. This course is designed to take the complexity out of learning object-oriented programming and show you how to use it effectively in real projects. In just a few hours, we will build an amazing project, an artificial life simulation in Python and Pygame. This project is the perfect way to learn all the key object-oriented programming concepts like classes, inheritance, polymorphism, and more. Through this hands-on experience, you will not only grasp these concepts, but also understand how to apply them to real-world scenarios, including your Arduino projects. Most importantly, you will finally see why we use object-oriented programming and how it makes programming easier, more efficient, and more manageable. If you are interested in understanding object-oriented programming once and for all, check the link in the video description. Now let's move on to another example. This time we will load a bitmap image onto our display. As you can see, I have loaded the Raspberry Pi Pico logo on the screen. How did I do that? Let's take a look at the code. It's surprisingly simple and only takes 4 lines. The magic happens in this line of code, where we use the drawRGB bitmap method to draw a byte array named logo. But you might be wondering, where does the byte array come from? It is defined in a separate file named logo.h. When we open this file, we can see that the image data is stored as an array of bytes, ready to be loaded onto the display. So to load a bitmap image onto the display, all we need is this single line of code, as long as we have the image in a byte array format. But here's the next step. How do we convert an image into a byte array? To solve this, I have created a simple Python script that makes the process quick and easy. This script uses the pillow library to take any image and automatically generate the necessary file in the correct format for our project. For example, here is an image file of the Arduino logo. Let's load it onto the display. First, I will place the image in the same folder as the Python script. Next, I'll open the script and define the output resolution of the image. This ensures the image fits perfectly on our display. Once the script runs, it generates the required byte array file, and we can use it in our code. Let's see it in action. I place the generated file into the Arduino project folder. Now, in my code, I just include the header file into my project. I change the name of the byte array to load, and I click upload. The Arduino logo appears on the display. It is that easy. By the way, if you find what I just shared with you useful, give this video a like so more people can learn about this easy procedure. Thank you very much. If you are a beginner with Arduino, the Adafruit library is the perfect choice to get started. It is super easy to use and requires no configuration, so you can dive right in without any hassle. To make it even easier, I have prepared a cheat sheet with all the available methods of the library, along with example usage, to help you get started quickly. You'll find the link to download it in the video description. Be sure to check it out. Now let's explore another option for more advanced users, the TFT ESPi library. This library is impressive because it's faster and more optimized than the Adafruit library, making it ideal for projects requiring better performance. Let's see how to set it up. First, we need to install the library. Click on the Library Manager button in the Arduino IDE. Search for TFT_ESPi and click the Install button. Once the installation is complete, however, we can't use the library immediately like some other libraries. The TFT ESPi library requires manual configuration to work with the Raspberry Pi Pico and the specific display you are using. This setup process involves editing the user setup.h file to define the correct pins and display parameters. While this extra step might seem a bit tricky, it gives you full control over how the library interacts with your hardware, ensuring the best performance. Let's dive into the configuration process. We have to open the libraries folder on our system. Typically, if you are using Windows, it is located at documents/arduino/libraries. Inside this folder, find the TFT ESPi folder that was created during the installation. Open it and you'll see a file named usersetup.h. This is the configuration file we need to edit. In the usersetup.h file, the first step is to define the display driver for the screen we are using. To do this, we have to locate the section where display drivers are defined. For the GC9A01 driver, you'll need to comment out any other display driver definitions and uncomment the line corresponding to the GC9A01 driver. This tells the library which display you are working with. Next, we need to specify the pins that connect your Raspberry Pi Pico to the display. Scroll down to the section where SPI pins are defined. For example, at line 170 or around that, modify the file to match your specific connections. We comment out this line, it is not needed in our project. TFT MOSI corresponds to pin 19, TFT SClock 18, TFT CS 20, TFT DC 17, and TFT Reset 16. Make sure this pin definition corresponds to how your display is wired to the Raspberry Pi Pico. After making these changes, save the file. Now our display is fully configured and ready to be used with the TFT ESPi library. We can load an example sketch from the library to test our setup and see it in action. In the Arduino IDE, navigate to File, Examples, TFT ESPi, Sprites, Animated Dial to see a fascinating demo program. This program displays a smooth and responsive dial that updates its position and values in real time. As you can see, it is a very practical feature that can be directly used in various projects like gauges, dashboards, or any interface requiring real-time feedback. Perfect. Next, let's load another example to demonstrate the speed of this library with the Raspberry Pi Pico and our display. I chose the bouncy circles example and modified the sketch to generate 80 circles instead of the default number. The display easily updates and redraws all 80 bouncing balls with no visible delay, showcasing the impressive performance of the TFT ESPi library and the Raspberry Pi Pico. This example highlights how well this setup handles high-performance tasks, making it perfect for projects like dynamic interfaces, animations, or even games. The possibilities with this display are endless, and I'm curious, have you used this display before, or are you planning to try it out in your next project? Let me know in the comments below. I would love to hear your thoughts and see what you are working on. If you found this video helpful, don't forget to like and subscribe to my channel. In a future video, we will build something exciting using this display. You won't want to miss it. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.